Last week, we had an opportunity to discuss this subject at length. And let me reiterate that the government stands fully committed to fulfill all legal obligations that we have towards the state of Andhra Pradesh in a peculiar situation arising out of the bifurcation of the state itself. I had in my reply last week said that there are a large number of commitments under the Andhra Pradesh Reorganization Act which the government is committed to. There was the statement made by the former Prime Minister, then as the Prime Minister of the country, which he has reiterated today and explained. And then there were observations very clearly made subsequently in the report of the 14th Finance Commission, a full paragraph that I had read. Now, on one of the issues, there seems to be apparently a divergence between what the Finance Commission says and one of the commitments made in the statement of the Honorable Prime Minister at that time. We are trying to reconcile how we can make good to the state of Andhra Pradesh any loss that they may suffer, rather than get into the legal argument of which prevails and so on. The government is at a very advanced stage in this consideration. The Honorable Chief Minister and members of Parliament from Andhra Pradesh even today had a meeting with the Honorable Prime Minister. And I'm sure that the issue would be resolved to the satisfaction of everybody. Now, coming to the second question, which is my objection. Sir, let me at the very outset say that I myself am a member of the upper house, and therefore when I am speaking in terms of the power and jurisdiction of the upper house, I may be disappointing some of my colleagues, including myself. But we must be clear about where we stand as regards the jurisdiction of the upper house is concerned. Under the rules of procedure, and the commentaries amplify this, there is no distinction between a bill moved by the government and a bill moved by a private member. The same set of constitutional guidelines as also the rules of procedure apply to both of them. In most matters, the two houses have jurisdiction which is independent and equal. The framers of the Constitution, however, kept certain matters away from the upper house and vested them only in the lower house. And the reason is the following. Probably the reason they must have done it. The Lok Sabha is a directly elected house. It's elected on a manifesto. The Rajya Sabha is an indirectly elected house.
No, please. No, no. Listen, listen. No, no. Listen to Ramachandra Rao. No. Please listen. No, please listen. No, no. Please listen. You listen. Please listen first. Okay.
And let me point out the points of difference within the jurisdiction of the two houses. Article 75(3) very clearly says the Council of Ministers is responsible to the House of People. Therefore, a government cannot survive a minority in the lower house. It can survive a minority in the upper house. A vote of confidence lies only in that house. It doesn't lie in this house. A vote of no confidence doesn't lie in this house. It lies only in the lower house. That's the first point of difference. The second question is in relation to money bills. And there are four specific rights that the lower house has, which the constitutional framers did not give to the upper house. Article 117 is very clear that a money bill can only be introduced in the Lok Sabha and not in the Rajya Sabha. It's clearly stated in so many words in the Constitution. The second, a money bill can only be voted in the Lok Sabha and not in the Rajya Sabha. The third, if a dispute arises as to whether a particular bill is a money bill or not, and a dispute has arisen, and I'll show what the dispute is, it's only the presiding officer of the Lok Sabha who can decide this issue and not of the Rajya Sabha. This is the third right that the Lok Sabha has. And the fourth right that the Lok Sabha has is, if the money bill fails, the Lok Sabha has a right to see that the government goes. Now this whole argument that these are special rights which only the Lok Sabha was given under the Constitution in regard to the money bills, these are four special rights which stem out of clear provisions of the Constitution itself. And Article 180 and Rule 186.7 clearly says that the procedure of this House is when a dispute arises as to what is a, whether it's a bill is a money bill or not, the presiding officer of the upper house will refer it to the Speaker Lok Sabha, whose decision is final. A certificate issued by the Speaker of the Lok Sabha is final in this regard. Now, what is a money bill? What is a money bill is clearly stated in Article 110.
No, please. No, listen. You have to listen. Why you have to listen? Listen. No, listen, please. Ram Jarao, listen. No, listen. You have to listen. No, Renegaji, I am not allowing. No. See, Finance Minister is speaking. He is on the floor. He's already speaking. Please. No, you spoke. You sit down. No, sir. Anyhow, you have to listen. No, listen. You already said it. Sit down. If you don't listen, what do I do? No. Renegaji by T8 is not proper. No. Listen. No. You have to listen. No. No, I have to listen. No, listen to me. That is not the issue here. Sit down. The issue is, listen, the issue is different. No, please. The issue is that Honorable Finance Minister has said that he has certain objection regarding this bill, and according to... No, please. It's a very serious matter. Listen properly, I'm telling you. A very serious matter. Honorable Finance Minister has said he has certain objection regarding this bill, and that objection, he said, he is going to raise that this is a money bill. And if he raises that objection, it is for me to listen to very carefully to his argument, so that I will have to take a decision as to whether the objection is valid or not. Therefore, if you don't want, no, if Renugaji doesn't want to listen, or some of you do not want to listen, I have to listen to this because I have to take a decision. Sit down. No, that is, nothing will go on record. Renegaji, this is unfair. No, I have to listen to that. You sit down. No. In any case, you understand, under Article 110 of the Constitution and 117 of the Constitution, you don't understand the seriousness of the issue and you want to say anything. See, it is very unfortunate. See, here, see,
Finance Minister is raising objection on the basis of Article 110 and 170 of the Constitution, and also Rule 180 is going to say. It is for the chair to listen to and understand it if I have to give a correct decision and ruling. So I have to listen to him. You can also, if you want, I will. Yes, I never said I will not allow you. but I have to listen to him because Finance Minister is raising the objection. So I am not allowing. I can allow you after that. Let me listen to Finance Minister and understand his objection. Yes, Honorable Finance Minister. Let me listen to you. I will allow you after that, not in between. Not in between. No. He is raising issue on the basis of the article of the Constitution. You sit down. No, sit down. Nonsense. Sit down. No. This is not allowed. See. No. Mr. Chaturvedi ji, we are all governed by the Constitution. That is our Holy Bible. The book. That is our book. He is quoting from that. Sir. I have to listen to it. Sit down. You are not above that. You are not above the Constitution. Sit down.
And Article.
You please.
What is the money bill?
I have to listen to that. No.
What is the money bill? Article 110 is very clear. For the purpose of this chapter, a bill shall be deemed to be a money bill if it contains only provisions relating to any or all of the following matters. Now, the word only has been already interpreted by a ruling of the Honorable Presiding Officer. Mr. Mavlankar's ruling has held the field. Why the word only has to be liberally construed, and that's a part of the parliamentary procedure. Any imposition of taxes, that's A, regulation or borrowing of money, D, appropriation of money from the consolidated fund, E, declaring any expenditure, etc., from the consolidated fund, any receipt from the consolidated fund, and any matters incidental. So government expenditure out of the consolidated fund of India, which has to be appropriated, can only be appropriated by a money bill. Imposition of taxation can only be by a money bill. And that money bill, there is a procedure under Article 117 governing that. Now, Mr. Rao's bill, amongst various factors, says special status, which translated in simple language means that instead of 60%, central government must give 90%. That's the only effect. Revenue deficit, even though we are giving it, but that's money. Special package for health, economic package. Central assistance package for the districts. Central assistance for development of the capital. Allocation of money for Polavaram. Rivers, resolution and assets division, etc., and so on for this. Now, most of the aspects that he mentions in his bill, most of the aspects that he mentions are expenditure coming out of the consolidated fund, which will have to be appropriated. Now, can that appropriation be done by the upper house? Can that bill be introduced in the upper house? That's the principal question, and that's a dispute. That's a dispute. And therefore, under Rule 186.7, it's very clear of the rules of procedure. On a bill being introduced in the council or at a subsequent stage, if any objection is taken that a bill is a money bill within the meaning of Article 110 and should not proceed within the council, the chairman shall, if he holds the objection to be valid, direct that further proceedings in connection with the bill will be terminated. If the chairman has any doubt in regard to the validity of the objection, he shall refer the matter to the speaker, whose decision on the question shall be final in accordance with Article 110.3. The provisions are very clear. Now, as I said, I am disappointing myself and my colleagues when I take this argument, because I myself am a member of this House. But we have to accept the reality that the framers of the Constitution gave a certain jurisdiction to the Lok Sabha. The jurisdiction under Article 75(3) of the Council of Ministers being responsible to them and a vote of no confidence, the money bill being introduced only there, the money being voted there, decisions on whether it's a money bill or not being decided there, and a government having to resign. Now, if I had the option, sir, kindly look at it from the converse. Assuming the government of a day loses majority and a money bill is being voted out in the Lok Sabha and the government has to resign, can the government stand up and say, now please treat it as a non-money bill? That option is not available, because 110 says a bill shall be deemed to be. The word is shall. This is not optional. And therefore, this house, even by consent between me and Mr. Jairam Ramesh, we can't confer jurisdiction on this house, which this house otherwise doesn't have. And therefore, this is a genuine doubt. The whole issue has to be referred. As far as the question of rights of the state of Andhra Pradesh are concerned, we are seized of that issue. We'll make sure that full justice is done to the state.
हाँ, इतना क्योंकि मैं तो स्पीच दे रहा था, मैंने नहीं देखा कि उसका लाइव टेलीकास्ट हुआ कि नहीं हुआ, लेकिन यह सच है कि भारत से जो दूरदर्शन और एएनआई के रिपोर्टर और हमारे पीटीआई के रिपोर्टर्स थे, उनको अंदर प्रवेश करने की इजाजत नहीं दी गई। यह सच है।